I have to say, these episodes have been nothing short of great, but astonishingly, the best is still yet to come.
A Sith Lord?
Man, there is a lot of great to get through with this one. The episode opens on the Jedi Temple with Dooku wandering the Jedi Library before we see that he's heading to the archives to remove the location of Kamino completely from the records using Cypher-Diez's clearance to bypass the security, now making Obi-Wan's pondering an attack of the clones funnier, as he was staring right at the man who was the reason for his frustration. This is further elaborated on in the deleted scene from that movie, but hey, it still works. On his way out, however, Dooku notices distant chatter from the other Jedi in the library and decides to inquire what the cause is for all this excitement to Jocasta Nu, who informs him that his apprentice Qui-Gon has claimed an encounter with none other than a Sith Lord, who we know to be Darth Maul, and now placing these events right slap bang in the middle of the Phantom Menace. There is also a display of doubt here from the other Jedi in the validity of Qui-Gon's claims, stating him to be from a man with a wild imagination. Jocasta Nu makes a valid comparison to Dooku himself, to which he states it is something that is valued less and less in these great halls. This realization is fitting, as he stated in the previous episode that victory can only be achieved by having heart and evolving. The question now being, how does one evolve without imagination? We then cut to Qui-Gon and Yaddle wandering the corridors of the Jedi Temple, Qui-Gon being voiced now by Liam Neeson, which is something I'll never tire of, and Yaddle here being voiced by Bryce Dallas Howard, who seems to be everywhere in Star Wars at the moment, which I'm totally here for, and does do a good job of the character. Dooku approaches them, inquiring about the Sith Lord Qui-Gon encountered, both expressing obvious but restrained frustrations at the response taken by the Council. I'm guessing mainly because Yaddle is standing right there. He eventually chimes in though and says that the Council is to be cautious until more is uncovered, but Yaddle still not denying that Qui-Gon's claims could have some validity, almost acting as a link between them and the Council, which shows that she does have some conflicting ideals herself, but not to the extent of Dooku and not enough to completely shun the Council at this point, which honestly gives Yaddle so much more character than before already. Dooku reminds Qui-Gon that a Sith Lord is not to be trifled with and he would not be there to protect him, which Qui-Gon reassures him by saying that he has Obi-Wan, who equips himself rather well. Dooku is happy to hear this and expresses his desire to meet him someday, as Qui-Gon is always singing his praises, which gives their actual meeting in Attack of the Clones way more meaning and fleshes out greater than the movie ever did by itself. After Qui-Gon leaves, Dooku looks on saying how they grew up so fast, further solidifying that Dooku views Qui-Gon not only as a Padawan but also as a son, before then taking his leave with some great symbolism on display of Dooku walking towards the dark and Yaddle toward the light. We cut to Dooku standing in front of the tree we know to be Force sensitive from the Clone Wars, accompanied by a hauntingly beautiful score that perfectly conveys the grief and depression he feels from the news of Qui-Gon's death, telling a newly arrived Yaddle that he used to take Qui-Gon here as a boy, elaborating to say that he was fascinated by it. Having been born on Coruscant, a planet of steel and stone, it was something he knew nothing like. This also makes a lot of sense for Qui-Gon's character, who's always been described as being very in touch and devoted to the living force, rather than the contemporary and modern devotions the other Jedi appear to have. Favouring the nature of the tree over the industrial materials of Coruscant being a good reflection of that core trait of his personality. Yaddle informs Dooku that the Council will be leaving for Naboo for the funeral, which Dooku says that he doubt he will be present and that Qui-Gon is now one with the living force, deeming it time to let him go. Yaddle questions Dooku's ability to do this, to which Dooku says, "What choice have I?" This scene is wonderfully done, as you can sense Dooku's heartbreak and anger regarding the death of Qui-Gon, but without having him have some kind of outburst and God forbid screaming, "No!" Which also from a fan's perspective is really interesting to see, as we've already seen some display of regret over the death of Qui-Gon years after the fact, but we can now see his fresh reaction, which brings a whole new context to his downfall, which is ever so imminently nigh. We get some pretty good mirroring in the next scene as we see Dooku taking off in what I believe is the same shuttle type in the exact same landing pad that Anakin took off from in Revenge of the Sith when he went to intervene at the Chancellor's office, which perfectly symbolises to us that whatever events are to transpire, like Anakin, Dooku would never be the same. Again, the music accompanying this is just absolutely breathtaking. This type of atmospheric synth music works so well in Star Wars. Blade Runner fans, you know what I'm talking about. Yaddle, clearly concerned for Dooku's well-being, follows him in her own vessel to the one place none of us want Dooku to go at this point. The works, where we know Palpatine to reside. Dooku meets with Sidious and voices his objection to allowing Maul to slay Qui-Gon on Naboo, which Sidious voiced magnificently as usual by Ian McDiarmid, points out that they both in fact have lost an apprentice, but is all in service of their greater goals. Dooku continues to object, claiming that he could have been a powerful ally, to which Sidious insists that he would have been for Dooku and Dooku alone. and then goes on to affirm that he still questions Dooku's loyalty and the Morbi art of him in order for success and confidence in Dooku's devotion. This exchange makes a lot of sense, as instead of endorsing Dooku's sorrow for the loss of Qui-Gon, he further uses it as manipulation to move against the Jedi and consider the loss as sacrifice to bring in order. This does work for getting off the subject of Qui-Gon, but does not stop Dooku from questioning all of his actions up until this point, still seeing a conflict within that is losing, but nevertheless fighting on within him. Yara then reveals herself, attempting to make a stop to the madness before her, which is spinning out of control. Sidious stating that he has been betrayed before Dooku denying this and moving in to face Yaddle. This prompt seemingly made very intentionally by Sidious to get Dooku to prove his loyalty, as he did the last time somebody questioned it at the beginning of the season. Yaddle tells Dooku that it is not too late, no matter his crimes, and he needs to help her bring the Sith Lord to justice. Sidious then reminding him his beliefs that the Jedi serve a corrupt Senate that fails the Republic it represents, preceded by kill her in a very typical Palpatine fashion. Dooku says he's afraid, only to finish the sentence with he's afraid it's too late before drawing his blue lightsaber, and Yaddle draws her green lightsaber? Oh, what? What happened to her orange lightsaber? Oh, now I'm complaining. I love orange lightsabers, and that would have been the perfect time to bring them into the canon. Oh, okay, I promise. That's the last time I'll bring up lightsaber colors in this, because really, who cares?
I do. I care.
They engage in a duel, which again has great mirroring to Luke and Vader's duel in Return of the Jedi, with her hiding away whilst pleading with Dooku to see reason. Similar to how Luke was while Vader was seeking him out in the throne room of the second Death Star. It's here also that Yaddle admits that Dooku was right about many things and reveals that she stepped down from her position on the council. Some, this may give full sense of security to why we don't see Yaddle in the other two prequels rather than her being killed in the next couple of minutes, but we don't have time to ponder on that as Dooku rips the obstruction out of the way and the fight resumes, ending with Dooku crushing Yaddle under the door? Oof. He drops to his knees with Palpatine dubbing him as his apprentice, telling him to raise. And to quickly point out, I'm glad Dooku didn't go, what have I done? As that would have been a little too on the nose for my liking. But no, Yaddle has a little fight left in her as she lifts the door with the Force, with the Force theme swelling over it. Palpatine hiding his face, presumably to hide his identity, but also I think one would be forgiven for thinking that he's just cringing at this level of light side power being on display here, the light reflecting off Dooku's face, also representing the last hope and essence of light that Yaddle is so desperately trying to bring out of him. Yaddle falls and reminds him of the suffering Dooku has caused for what he calls order. Dooku does what he considers mercy and brings peace to Yaddle, ending the suffering she's claimed he has caused, and strikes her down, ending with a fade-out on Palpatine, with only his Sith yellow eyes being visible before cutting to black. Kind of like the VHS cover of Episode 1, if anyone remembers that. Like, it had Darth Maul's eyes, but nothing else in the background. Just put him on the cover, yo. Yeah, this episode is absolutely masterful. I don't think it's an unpopular opinion to say that this is the best episode of the season. He does everything right, and again, coupled with the previous episode, really makes us care about Dooku and understand his eventual fall to the dark side and transformation to Darth Tyranus. Who would have thought that seeing a duel between Dooku and Yaddle would be so compelling and emotional? Considering the nothing that we've had from Yaddle up until this point is a testament to how well Filoni managed to set everything up with great emotional payoff at the end in only 15 minutes once again. This really is one of the best episodes of Star Wars I've seen in years, and this series really has given me so much context for things I didn't know I needed. But wait, there's more. The penultimate episode opens once again on Coruscant, where Anakin appears to be running late for Ahsoka's training, an exercise other Jedi are allowed to go and spectate. Obi-Wan turns to him and reassures him that he's right on time, to which Anakin says he thought he was late. Obi-Wan then playfully saying that that's what I meant. Obi-Wan then goes on to say that she's a fast learner, to which Anakin replies, I really wouldn't know, which I presume is a fun reference to this line he said in Attack of the Clones.
I am a slow learner.
Ahsoka seems to be faring well against these training remotes that we learn are meant to imitate battle droids. The exercise is also being instructed by Terra Sanube, who decides it's time to ramp up the difficulty. So he pulls out his lightsaber, and narrows the playing field, so to speak. We see here also a young Kanan Jarrus, or known at the time as Caleb Dune, who is accompanied by his master Depa Balab. Here Caleb seems taken and in awe by Ahsoka's performance, which is pretty interesting as these two would be fighting side by side some years later. Anakin isn't so impressed though, stating that it's a test every Jedi does, so we'll do nothing to make Ahsoka fare any better than your run-of-the-mill Jedi, but tells her that he will have a real test for her in the coming days. Ahsoka meets Anakin some days later, Anakin telling her that she's right on time, with Ahsoka, like Anakin, saying she thought she was late, with Anakin, like Obi-Wan, saying that's what I meant, showing that Anakin is enjoying being the one doing the snarky telling off for a change in a fun little way. As they enter, Captain Rex and a squadron of clones are waiting, and this training exercise proves to be fairly similar to the original, only this one being with clones rather than training droids. Evidently, this proves to be a greater task for Ahsoka as she takes many hits, falling from their stuns in comparison to the ease she had taking on the training remote, passing out for hours at a time, which eventually tires her patience. She confronts Anakin, claiming the exercise to be ridiculous, saying that the droids aren't half as good as Rex's men. Anakin states that that is the point, and that if she can take on Rex's men, then she'll be ready for anything on the battlefield, claiming the best way for him to protect her is to teach her to protect herself. This is great because as we're watching this, we're seeing Anakin unknowingly train Ahsoka for Order 66, a luxury not all Jedi appeared to have. Yeesh. But no, it further sheds light on why so many Jedi fell in Order 66, and why it ended up being so effective to Palpatine's plan, as we all know that the Jedi were so focused on training their students on how to face droids, that as soon as they go up against something more advanced, it's going to be completely alien to them in how to properly push back against it, making the whole ordeal that much more believable, and also Ahsoka's capability to take them on at the end of the Clone Wars that bit more believable as well. This training routine also seemingly taking place over quite a long time. We see that near the end, she is using two lightsabers. Anakin's hair is also longer. That isn't the only thing though, Ahsoka is also a lot more capable now, being able to last for much longer periods of time, with her confidence clearly having had some growth as well. The episode ends on a familiar setting as Rex and Ahsoka are on the Republic Corvette, the same place we saw them in the Clone Wars finale, Rex hoping that all her training has paid off before going to meet the clones in the final conflict aboard the cruiser. But yeah, this episode's good. It didn't quite reach the heights of the Dooku ones, but it's solid. Main selling point being the context that it gives to Order 66, and seeing more of Anakin as a Jedi Master, which are both great to see. It is one of the shorter ones as well, so I definitely give it props for being able to do what it did in even less amount of time than the Dooku stories. But for me, still didn't quite reach the heights of engagement that those did. But yeah, overall, another good episode. Now, on to the finale. Opens on a sad but familiar setting as we pick up on the funeral of Padme Amidala. It's here that we not only see that Bail Organa has made it before going to swap child living arrangements with Obi-Wan and Yoda, but Ahsoka is in attendance as well, which, can I say, I find it kind of astonishing how Filoni seems to be able to constantly fit Ahsoka in and around the events of the movies, and does it without destroying the canon and causing a paradox, ultimately destroying the fabric of the galaxy as a whole, despite constantly being so close to doing so without being as careful as he is. Which, whether you think it's necessary or not, you gotta admit, it is impressive.
Most impressive.
Bail and Ahsoka meet to discuss the recklessness of her attendants, with the Empire now hunting her, but she states that she doesn't care as Padme was her friend. Which is good to see, as we never really saw how the death of Padme affected her, or any reaction to that fact of any kind. Bail then extends his offer of support, handing her a device in case she needs his help in the future, to which she refuses, claiming that she's tired of fighting. The conversation is cut short as two clones approach, forcing Ahsoka to hide. Whilst being questioned by the clones, Bail manages to indirectly say that if you should ever need anything, please contact me. Which is meant for Ahsoka, still listening from above, which kind of reminded me of the follow the spiders message from Chamber of Secrets. Ahsoka drops down to meet Rex, which I guess now confirms they left together after the clone memoriam that they made at the end of the Clone Wars, then taking off to see what lies ahead for them next. We cut to some years later as we see that Ahsoka's found a new life. She stops one of her peers from being crushed by a falling cart of hay by using the Force to save her, in which doing so, blowing her cover as someone who's force sensitive. I can't say this is really treading new ground, as we've already seen this before in other Star Wars media, only this time it's Ahsoka and it's... hey. In the next scene, we learn there's mixed emotions regarding the Empire, some seeming against them, but one being overwhelmingly supportive to it, stating that they pose no threat to people like them, but only to the rebels who threaten the peace. The girl whom Ahsoka saved approaches her, saying that she knows Ahsoka is a Jedi and expresses excitement to having a Jedi in their midst, which Ahsoka denies, but to no persuasion of her peer, who reassures her that it'll be their little secret. This conversation isn't as private as they think, however, as the Imperial Loyalist is listening into the entire conversation, and chooses to hint fairly openly the next day to Ahsoka by saying, May the Force be with you, which concerns Ahsoka, but not enough to take action on this occasion. Nightfall approaches with Ahsoka coming back to the farmland to see it ablaze and an Inquisitor holding the survivors on their knees at the mercy of his blade. The Imperial loyalist claiming he should be rewarded for turning in the Jedi who was nowhere to be seen. When Ahsoka reveals herself, the Inquisitor seems happy to oblige and moves to strike the killing blow, claiming that to be his reward. Ahsoka manages to throw him out of the way with the Force, leaving the battleground open between her and the Inquisitor, who recognizes her and eagerly awaits the reward that he will likely get for striking her down. The score here is really cool, highlighting Ahsoka's return to having to do what she vowed to leave behind, as they engage in a brief conflict before she manages to decapitate him with his own lightsaber with relative ease. Now, this Inquisitor hasn't been named at this point, so I'm not sure if he was once a Jedi that she knew from the Order, or if it's just down to her reputation. But that is left unclear, and I'm also not sure if this Inquisitor's lightsaber is the one that she purifies the crystals from and uses in the other series down the line, or if I've got that completely wrong. So I won't state that as a fact, but if anyone knows, then please let me know. The episode then draws to a close with Ahsoka finally calling Bail Organa in for that favor to get the remaining survivors to safety, and to finally get herself back into the fight, setting stage for Fulcrum, her meeting with Grogu and Mando, and all the other events to come down the line. So yeah, I enjoyed this episode as well. Again, it's a fairly similar scenario that we've seen other Jedi have to go through, like Obi-Wan Kenobi and Cal Kestis being the main two that come to mind. But it's nice to see that there was a transitional period between the Clone Wars and where we see her in Rebels and then eventually everything else. So with that being the main point that's going for it, I would say it was a jolly good time. So what do I think of the show overall? Well, yeah, what can I say other than Dave Filoni, you've done it again. At the time of this recording, it hasn't been announced if there'll be other seasons of this show coming out, but I'm gonna say now, I want to see more. There is so much more you could do with this format. Flesh out more Jedi, like maybe Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan's relationship pre-Phantom Menace, or give us more on the other council members. Hell, maybe even the dark side version, like Tales of the Sith, Tales of the Dark Side, or whatever. Explore Darth Maul or Palpatine, or hell, even Hego Damask / Darth Plagueis. Or, if you want to go even further back, then Darth Bane and give us the insight into the start of the Rule of Two. In any case, it's hard not to want more after seeing how well they did here with characters like Count Dooku, who the movies didn't really seem to give a shit about fleshing out his downfall. They basically limited it to a few lines of dialogue and pretty much got done with it. Now I'm just wanting to know more and more about his time as a Jedi. And this gave me some part of that, which to be honest is something I never knew I wanted, which I can't praise this show enough for. It is for that reason that I did like the Dooku ones more, as I think at this point Ahsoka's gotten enough development and these were more nice little treats rather than fully needed installments to her character. Enjoyable as they were, and I will always love seeing more Ahsoka in any kind of media. But yeah, if I had to go with any complaints, I would probably have called this something else, as not to alienate the old EU fans. In my case, I didn't read the Tales of the Jedi comics, so this didn't really affect me. But I know for a fact that if they tried to call this Knights of the Old Republic, then I'd probably be fuming. So I can understand why some fans may be irate and jaded by the choice to call this the same as something else they loved whilst having nothing to do with the comics it shares a title with. That aside, I do wish there was more here, but what we got for the most part, I couldn't be happier with. So yeah, a great series of shorts, which does grand service to the lore. If anyone is interested in what I'd rate these episodes individually, then I'll put them up here. Cool. But overall, I would give Tales of the Jedi an 8.4 out of 10. Thank you all for watching this, and I hope you enjoyed the show as I did. And let's pray that Filoni has more to write during the production of Ahsoka, or The Mandalorian Season 3, as that would be an absolute treat. I was half of Bantha Fodder. This was Tales of the Jedi. Bye.